Good evening from the Usha Kasera Lecture Theatre here at the University of Edinburgh in Edinburgh, Scotland, and welcome to the 27th edition or the 27th season of the Montgomery Cup. My name is Jordan Compton. I am the Director of Forensics at the University of Central Missouri, and I will be your host for this evening as we prepare to hear a debate on the motion of this House would defend freedom at all costs. I am joined by the current president of the University of Edinburgh Debate Union, Nora Flynn McKeever, and we will be guiding you through this process as much as possible. We are looking forward to what should be an excellent debate here this evening with the delegates from the United States being represented by the University of Central Missouri, Lee College, and Louisiana State University Shreveport versus the team, our host from here, the University of Edinburgh. Prep time has been going on for several minutes now, and we are just minutes away from the debate beginning, and we will, whenever it is time, we will sit back and relax and watch the debate. So Nora, we had the coin flip. What happened? Okay, excellent. So our Speaker of the House, our Chief Adjudicator, is Esme, I believe?
Esme,
yes. Yeah, Esme. Okay, so she will be the Chief Adjudicator. We now have, I believe, all of our participants in the debate hall, and we will sit out and let Esme do her thing.
Welcome to sunny tropical Edinburgh. We're really excited to have you all here. Thank you so much for including us on your world trip. I am Esme. I am the chair of this debate. I was picked because of my own merits, not because of a coin flip. in OG, we're going to have Jerry and CJ. On OO, we have Kian and Wood on. On CG, we have Adam and Brooke. And on CO, we have Jamie and Caleb. We trust it's going to be a really fun evening of debating and also just getting to know all of you. Thank you so much.
In the 1930s, Neville Chamberlain made one of the most costly and deadly decisions for Europeans and the rest of the world. He chose to focus on a political strategy of appeasement, allowing Nazi Germany to accumulate more power, more land, and resources, until eventually they became the military war machine that could not be stopped. And with that being said, we ask that today we do not make the same mistake, which is why we must accept this motion, and in fact, we're getting into right to that motion. But before I get into there, obviously we're going to talk about some definitions. We're going to provide a model, and then we're going to go into our two substantive points. As far as the definitions go, this House would defend freedom at all costs. This House, being defined as NATO, would, obviously this is not a round or a discussion of probability, but more so whether or not this is a good idea. Freedom is the power to act and speak and do what you want. And we believe that the biggest catalyst or the number one scenario in which we're seeing freedoms being taken away is that of Ukraine. We see that when we're looking at all costs, we are saying no matter the consequences. And we will be advocating for boots on the ground in today's round or today's discussion. With that being said, let's get to the model. First and foremost, we believe it necessary to have a 30-day warning. Before we jump into this conflict, we have to give them a chance to stand down. Also, we are going to draw a line in the sand, reestablishing borders before the Ukrainian war. And obviously, with this being named NATO, this is going to be a coalition of around 30 nations working in conjunction with this specific scenario. And with that being said, let's get on to our first substantive point. I'll answer my first question.
Is a draft freedom?
What was that?
Is a draft freedom?
No, sir. No, it is not. But ultimately, at the point in which this is a coalition and this is working in conjunction, I do not believe that a draft would be necessary. Let's get to our first substantive point. The first point is going to be the idea of curbing Russian expansion. One of the major justifications for World War II, in fact, why nations were getting, most nations were getting involved, was because we saw Nazi Germany claiming lands, resources, and taking away large rights away from large groups. What is happening now? The exact same thing. Russia is destroying sovereignty and taking freedoms away from a group known as the Ukrainians. I'll answer my second question.
So you define freedom as the ability to do whatever you want. So in this perfect world, we would allow people to kill each other without consequences?
No, again, we're looking in today's discussion about specifically the Ukrainian conflict. I don't think that allowing people to just kill people left and right is necessarily what this discussion is asking us to prove. But let's get back into it. When we're talking about what happens now, again, Russia is destroying sovereignty and thus destroying freedom. But what? Why does this matter for Russian expansion? Well, we see that, in fact, what they're going through is a success story. Essentially, we saw in Crimea invaded. They lost. What happened next? Ukraine. So what happens if Ukraine, again, loses this conflict? Well, again, I ask the question, who is next? And we'll get to that in a little while. But secondly is the idea of feeding the war machine. One of the major, another major reason was the for invading Ukraine was the fact that there were resources, oils, minerals, and in fact, the fact that it's a strategic buffer from NATO. Russia spans two continents, bordering more than a dozen countries. And what we see is that they already have their next choice. We see that, in fact, they shot missiles over, or sorry, through Poland's airspace. And we see that in response, a year later, Poland has responded by trying to mobilize its forces. But what does this line in the sand actually do? Well, I would say that when we look historically, it has provided opportunities to, again, curb expansionism. When we look at the idea of the Cuban Missile Crisis, historians would say that that was the closest we have gotten to nuclear war, but ultimately it didn't happen. Even more so, we created that line, and we would argue that that line continues to essentially work, and we need to, again, promote it. At the point at which all these nations are working together, I don't believe that Russia has a chance. But let's go on to the next point, which is the idea of precedence. We have to understand that even though we're talking about Russian expansion directly, there is an indirect impact to other nations. It discourages future aggressive actors from, again, destroying smaller nations and taking away that nation's freedoms. This, in fact, might not jeopardize, we might not be at risk today, but we could sure as heck be at risk tomorrow. And that takes us to our second substantive point, which is the idea of saving lives. 500,000 dead, 30,000 missing, 3.6 million displaced, 15 million in vulnerable positions. That's what we're seeing today. And if we choose to do nothing, those numbers grow. I'll answer my next question.
So you mentioned boots on the ground in your first beginning of the speech. What exactly are the costs that you're willing to give up in order to protect people at all costs?
Well, I would say we're looking at resources. We're looking at, obviously, the war is going to cost lives. But ultimately, this is an issue that, in fact, surpasses all of essentially just one nation. Going on a little bit further, military involvement ensures that we can create safe zones. We can drop humanitarian aid. Well, why can't we drop humanitarian aid right now? Well, doing that in an active war zone is not going to be too effective. Creating those, in fact, safe zones means that, in fact, we can have opportunities to save the individuals who are affected today and infected tomorrow. When, again, we look at the Cuban Missile Crisis as a phenomenal example of when we were able to check Russia. But ultimately, let's understand that that warning is important. There is an opportunity for us to not shed even more bloodshed. But ultimately, it still requires this motion. We would say that Ukrainians should still be a priority, even if we are not seeing that impact today. Most people would say it's not the, let's understand that NATO's major reason for existing is to check Russia. And so even if they're not affected today, these countries will be affected tomorrow. These countries can be affected in the future. We cannot stay idle in the face of this. I understand that there are consequences. I understand that there is loss of life, but that is happening already. What can we do to solve this problem? It requires a coalition. It requires nations working together because of the fact that we are seeing freedoms, liberties, sovereignty being harmed left and right when we're looking at Ukraine. Thank you so much.
So that was Jerry McCauley from Lee College.
No man is an island, entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, part of the main. Our existence is predicated on mutual dependency. Our happiness and suffering are predicated on our obedience to our moral obligations, our duty to others, and our duty to our communities. Firstly, some clarifications on the burdens of this debate. This debate is not solely about the war in Ukraine and is not solely about the actions of NATO. Open and government have the power to make arguments within this context and certainly to win on it if they do prove that those arguments are the most important within this debate. But to truly defend this motion and to truly defend the burdens on which this motion places on them, they need to defend within a general context freedom being defended at all costs. This means between individuals, this means with a specific care placed on the defense of freedom and with specific care placed on what those costs are. Two additional clarifications. At all costs implies that this is the ultimate burden in this debate. Freedom is traded off against things like pleasure and pain. It's traded off against things like utilitarian impacts within this debate, and it's necessarily something that has to be proven to dominate these other considerations to a significant extent. Defense implies some responsibility on the part of any actor in a general sense. In order to judge this debate, you need to pay attention carefully to how this freedom is being defended, how freedom is being traded between individuals, and whether that's done to the best extent. First argument, freedom is morally unimportant because free will does not exist. Firstly, the universe is nothing more than a combination of physical atoms and particles, moving in ways that are strictly governed by the laws of nature, strictly governed by physics, chemistry, and biology. Second, the universe is deterministic when it comes to these laws. Every event has a cause. Every event is caused by previous actions, and those previous events caused themselves by previous actions. Our actions, ourselves, the decisions that we make, decisions are themselves caught up in this chain of unbroken causality, and thus our thoughts and actions can have no substantial effect on the future because they themselves have been determined by previous events. And finally, biological determinism and why that means that our actions can have no potential impact on the future. Human behavior is ultimately dictated by neurological and chemical processes that we just cannot control. The thoughts in our head are ultimately physical phenomena that exist within the same chain of events that I've just talked about. Therefore, our decisions are never truly free. So far in this debate, Open and Government has defended freedom without justifying its moral importance in connection or in defense of other moral considerations. The moral consideration that we should judge this debate by is utilitarian outcomes.
Question.
Why is this the case? Not right now, I'll take you in a second. First of all, utility is a shared intuition. It's something we all understand. We understand the feeling of pleasure, we understand the pain of harms to others and what pain means for every individual. We can see it on other people's faces. We understand the value of it without having to follow steps of logic as to understand why it is good or bad. Secondly, utility is arithmetic. It is a system which produces clear moral outcomes, no matter the case. We don't have to, you know, have debates about whether something is good when we see another person harmed. We know that that is a trade-off. We know that we can make a moral judgment, and it is the easiest metric, therefore, to judge this debate on. Before I go on, sure, opening.
Got you. So in that first point about decisions we make don't impact the future, in what world is that actually true?
This world. Okay, with that metric established, one significant argument. Compliance in a system is necessary to uphold the common good. I think that total freedom disrupts the ways in which society functions. Necessarily, people just choose not to show up to work. Our own egoistic ideal of what our freedoms should look like necessarily are in competition with other people. Our defense of freedom is necessarily in competition with somebody else's freedom. Even in cases where there is war, there is obviously a trade-off when it comes to defending the case of Ukraine. You are necessarily restricting other people's freedoms. If government cannot show that in all cases, freedom is upheld, freedom is necessarily the thing that they are maximizing, then they cannot win this debate without a justification of the relative importance of different people's freedoms. Yeah. I don't think that they're going to be able to do this. I think that any justification is going to rely on utilitarian premises, and therefore is the metric that we're still going to be able to win on. Before I go on, closing.
Does it matter if free will doesn't exist, if people believe that free will exists?
It definitely does matter, because generally that is, you know, just the reality of the case, right? Even if people within their own heads believe that free will exists, that is just a metric by which they derive utility, and so it is still on our side of the debate. Firstly, on why compliance necessarily upholds the social good. I think generally it is because of reciprocity to your fellow citizens. Individuals commit a moral wrong when they fail to contribute to the social enterprises from which they benefit. Necessarily, the productive economy benefits everybody to some extent, right? You walk into this building not because you built it with your own hands, but because other people allowed you to exist within society, because other people made your meal, because other people provided those ingredients to you, Society is governed by our mutual dependence on our fellow citizens, right? Necessarily, freedom from that system is going to disrupt the entire social order by which we derive those benefits. Nobody can exist in a society which does not cooperate. Without cooperation, and cooperation relying on reciprocity, you just generally cannot exist and benefit from any common good between individuals. Secondly, constraints on the freedom of dangerous individuals protects the common good, quite trivially, right? Dangerous criminals should not obviously be able to roam the streets. This is first because guilty people quite obviously deserve some form of punishment. What is punishment but restrictions on freedoms? It's being able to govern, to allow innocent people to feel safe, to feel that they can live into the future and feel that they can derive some kind of happiness into the future. No, thank you. I think, just generally, this also just protects current victims and future victims of any violence. People can walk down the street, feel that they are able to maximize their own happiness going into the future, and continue to be productive members to society because they aren't crippled by the fear of having to live with other people that, of which freedom has not been curtailed and has not been curtailed justly. Thirdly, on social norms. Freedom from the norms that govern society lead to lawlessness and domination of the strong. Note that norms are the means by which people are offered stability when they go outside, when they are able to enter into relationships having reasonable expectations of what norms govern society. Generally, it is the basis of feeling that you can enter into, you know, relationships that are profitable for you, that allow you to derive happiness, and they are the basis of communities and shared identities. They are the ways by which we establish connections to others and a feeling by which we are at home in the world. Without a social norm, without an expectation that other people are altruistic, that they maximize your own utility as well as their own, we cannot live within the world. With respect to Werdan's POI, I think drafting in World War II was especially important, because even though it restricted the personal freedoms of the people that were drafted. It allowed, you know, the world to continue existing in its current state of democratic order, in which people did not lose their freedoms from being invaded. Military occupancy is an ultimate, you know, curtail of your own utilitarian outcomes, and we think that in those cases, we should be able to defend freedom. We win this debate because we prove that in a general sense, there are costs that are too high to protecting freedom. There are costs that we cannot stand behind. For all of those reasons, very proud to oppose.
And welcome the Deputy Prime Minister to continue the speech.
First they came for the Crimeans, and we did nothing. Now they come for Ukrainians, and we're doing, well, effectively nothing else. I ask you, no, I charge you with action. Action because it is necessary. The government side is asking you to defend freedoms. What I'm going to do in this speech is very simple. I'm going to address the framework, get into the speech and case given, and then extend out what my partner brought up. Firstly, on responses to how this round is set up, now I want to point out one interesting thing. The opposition does not engage at all with opening government. At all. Nothing. And that's because they stand by the idea that we have to defend this in a general sense. And here's why that's a mistake, right? We're providing framework, as the open government is allowed to do, right? A framework, our pedestal, our stance of debate. And what we are having to do is we're using Ukraine as the ultimate current example, right? Ukraine is a perfect example of a nation sovereignty that is being affected, freedoms being affected, that NATO is coming to defend. So while you hear a lot of philosophical, basically, frothings, you do not hear actual substance. And we'll get further into that lack of substance later. Addressing first point of lack of substance, let's talk that first substantive point on free will doesn't exist. Here's where they're mistaken. The first point is, I ask, I'll get that in just a second. The first point is, whenever they bring up the idea that our decisions don't impact the future, yeah, I ask, when, in what world is this true? And they say this one, and yeah, they laugh. That's because they didn't think their point through. Because in no world or society is this actually a thing. Here's why. I choose, through my own free will, to, say, take opening government, right? And that, therefore, affects how the rest of this round goes. My one decision affects the things surrounding me. Our opponents even agree with this by saying our decisions cause and effect. So their own logic does not prove the point they think it does. As they say in Macbeth, while they are full of sound and fury, it ultimately signifies nothing. Now, I'd love some clarification with that POI.
Is the right to attack you overcome by your right to defend yourself? Where do these freedoms lie?
So when we see in status quo that one nation is clearly being attacked with their freedoms being completely infringed and subjugated upon, we have the obligation, we should go after that attacking force as we advocate for on the government side. Nextly, on the point of utility, basically utility being shared intuition, utility is arithmetic. My main response to this idea is that there's no actual impact to that of freedom, right? You don't hear an actual tie back to why this is important. And it's very important because it again shows a lack of substance. But finally, addressing the point on relative importance, basically this idea of you're committing a moral wrong if not acting within a utilitarian system of sorts that the opposition puts forward. Basically, what I'm telling you is that the opposition has put themselves in this ivory tower, talking about it's morally wrong to do this, morally wrong to do that, with one, no impact, but two, what morality system are they doing? Do not let the opposition enforce their own code of moral ethics onto you. Instead, go with freedom, as we put forward, to act, speak, do as you like, or the sovereignty of a nation. Just one second. And furthermore, when we get to the third substantive point on freedom from norms and stability, there's no logic or real analysis as to how this is separate from defending freedoms, right? We are defending the social norm of Ukraine existing by going with the government plan. When we get into those key extensions, before I do that, I will take one more question from over here.
Do you think people ought to pay their taxes?
People ought to pay their taxes if they choose with their freedom to live in a society, then maybe so, right? Ultimately, we're not talking about taxes, we're talking about, again, Russia and Ukraine. And further expanding on Russia and Ukraine, what we're here to talk about, let's talk that one extension that I've got for you, which is real peace in our time. My partner briefly opened up with Neville Chamberlain, and I am twisting his quote of peace in our time because by doing what the government asks of you, what we charge of to take action and defend the freedom of Ukraine, we are inviting further unity and safety, and we are standing against encroaching imperialist power, which is ultimately the ultimate defense against freedom in a global sense, because we are all standing together, standing united and against encroaching imperialism. And we see this very clearly shown in examples when we draw that clear line in the sand, when we make that state, when we make that status against Russia, against other colonialist forces, such as the Cuban Missile Crisis, such as whenever Russia said, no, US, if you invade, if you do anything in Vietnam, we'll attack or we'll take action. And the US didn't really answer that. The impact is clear. Russia is afraid. They'll never do anything harsh, right? What we see very clearly with the government side is actual key defense of freedoms. We see more than just philosophical froth. We see actual substance. We see true, genuine argumentation and true, genuine resolutional arguments. And it's with that that I charge you with action, not because it is easy, but because it is difficult. It is the difficult action, but that does not change the fact that it is the necessary action. And therefore, at all costs, it is vital that we defend freedom, both from the encroaching threat of Russia onto Ukraine, but the future encroaching threat of Russia on the rest of the world at large. Take a stance with government. Thank you.
Sadly and truthfully, something that is far more complex with genuine trade-offs than at all costs can ever begin to justify. For what they need to stand behind is something that is much harder to stomach than the conceptual idea of instrumentalization or agency or these freedoms that some people think matter that other people think don't. They have to sacrifice the relationship that is shared between me and you and us and them for the victory of the ego, something I do not think they've been able to convince themselves of, and I'm closing will fare any better. First, firstly, let's just engage with an opening government and prove why their metrics are out of this debate. Firstly, I just don't think we have to engage with Russia and UK being the metric, as far as Kiana just said, it's just much wider. We cover much more people, we cover much more instances, and situations should be much more important or much less important. I think we just cover that all. But let's deal with it even if we are looking into the lens of NATO and Ukrainian war. Because they tell us this does not require a draft because people will just willingly do it. People choose to do this out of their own heart. And as an opposition, we have to make this hard decision. We are willing to take the harms of what drafting someone into a war truly means, of taking people from their families, of having mothers and fathers worry about their sons and daughters, for stripping agency away from them, and then therefore stripping freedom away from them for the purpose of saving future mothers and fathers for not having to worry about the same thing. Because a man needs to be instrumentalized for a family to live. And it's not just government or random philosophers like Kant are not willing to make this trade-off. We not only have to make this trade-off with a heavy heart, but this is one that countless others have had to make before us. We make it understanding that it is just, and I think every person at least owes a good amount to it. They start their speech criticizing Neville Chamberlain, but don't understand what it is that has led Winston Churchill to make the decision which he needed to do to go into war with in the first place. It is opposition that is truly able to take the benefits of that. I'll take opening.
Got you. So since Russia usually historically backs off whenever we take a stance, wouldn't there not need to be a draft because there wouldn't really be a military conflict?
Well, the point is that we're still able to do all you want on our side of the house as well, right? At the point at which we don't think freedom has to be protected at all costs, we still think freedom does matter, and we still think freedom does matter, like, it still can have some cost tied to it, and insofar as you have proven that this is something that does matter, then yeah, sure, we'll do what you want, I guess, but we are still winning on our side. Note this level of responsibility is one that we do think is binding, right? We are bound by the actions and inactions of our forefathers, and all we exist is to make sure their actions don't uncall for. And this is why we believe a mother who has an obligation towards her child does not have the freedom to walk away from it. This is why we think that is someone who deserves to be punished if they don't help her. This is why we think when someone who doesn't pay taxes is not accounting for their obligation towards societies, and why forcing these things are to be paid. Because fundamentally, we do not think the freedom for someone to get away with this outweighs the freedom of someone being able to eat or go to sleep safe at night, or being able to send their children to school and university from the scholarship money that you're able to get from those taxes in the first place. The infringement of one's freedoms is fundamentally important itself to care about other things that we value, because OG make it incredibly unclear as to what freedom actually is. They just put their own subjective definition out there, but what is one man's freedom is another man's oppression. At the point at which I don't know if this is the freedom for Ukraine to defend itself, or is this the freedom for a man to not be sought into war, it is only an opposition we're able to make that complex trade-off. And it's, let's talk about the way then. Firstly, on free will, and I know this seems unintuitive at first, but our choices cannot come from a framework that we're able to consent into. I cannot control who I am, I cannot control who I'm born into, I cannot control what I think and therefore what decisions I'm able to make. These are just things that I'm doing and not consciously thinking about, right? Can you truly say what the next thing that comes out of your mouth is an action or decision that you truly accounted and called for? And what this means then, that there's no independent good called freedom that we can refer back to. There's no true moral agent or way that we can assign to it. What we do assign to it is the feeling of freedom, the feeling of doing what you want, and the feeling of feeling as if you can do whatever you wish to do to going forward. Because a man in a cage who believes he is free is still a man in a cage, but at the point at which he believes he is free, that he's able to get all the benefits out of freedom. Look, firstly, I think it is unable to categorize where one person's freedom and another person's harm begins, at the point at which it is subjective, just resorting to freedom leads to more harms occurring. But secondly, it means that the underlying basis of any government claim has to be utility. Because at the point at which they resort back to the feeling of freedom, it means you're just resorting back to the utilitarian claims in the first place. And at that point, this is where we're able to claim the benefits of just doing good, feeding people, and housing people in the first place that we just think are higher order forms of utility that are more base and more pressing towards someone living within life in the first place. And this is where it is fine to draft tools for a just war when those do occur. And this leads on to my second piece of weighing, because even if you don't buy anything about free will not existing, right, we're still, and you do think that freedom itself is an independent good, we're going to show why that is something that still should be held up to other considerations within life. I'll take closing. Do you have one? I'll take another one for opening.
Okay, so a lot of your argumentation is based off subjectivism, determinism, free will not existing. Doesn't all that just justify inaction throughout the entirety of life?
Not especially really, right? All it justifies is that you should think about your obligations beforehand. You shouldn't resort to one specific modem of thinking to make your decision and decisions, because realistically, when we make decisions within our lives, you don't just think what maximizes freedom. We think about a bunch of other different things. My obligations towards my friends and the actions that I do, or the benefits that I have to not commit harm or not do harm. Morality is complex, and we make decisions on a bunch of different bases. To resort it back to one is a thing which subjectivizes us. Secondly, and this really leads on to freedom being worth traded off sometimes, because no moral decision will ever be perfect, and one person's good will lead to one person's another person's harm may lead to bad things occurring. And at a point at which you can never objectively clarify to correct, we should one resort to the safest and most defensible method for it. He tells you it's utilitarianism, but that's because it can be measured, not because it takes account on the things such as scale, intensity, the different higher orders between reading a poem or going to the gym or getting blackout drunk at night. These are things which can be accounted for with utility on different levels and bases of it. But secondly, even if government proved that utilitarianism isn't perfect in all and every case, this only shows the need to weigh our obligations independently of one another and where in which they matter. Sometimes this is just the only realistic way of making correct and moral decisions, regardless of whatever metric you use. But even if that's what you guide, utility is the one that allows you this complexity and is the underpinning of it all. Because sometimes freedom prerequisites utility, but sometimes it doesn't. And we get to claim these scenarios, government can never do so. I'll take a third one, sure.
Oh, thank you so much. So a lot of your argumentation is based off preferring utilitarianism, but doesn't the affirmative proposition basically work off utilitarianism, greatest good for the greatest amount of people?
Well, yeah, that's the point, right? But sometimes when you have utilitarianism, you have to trade off freedom. You never told me in those scenarios where trading off freedom is worth it, right? But you've also never told me in the scenarios in which freedom is an independent good that we should sort for in all cases. You have to stand behind defending freedom even when it leads to people living worse lives overall, or when it does not lead to the overall amount of good within occurring. Government have to show why freedom is an independent good in and of itself. All we have to show there are just other things that exist, and we should think about these other things when we're drawing up the decisions within our lives. Very clear opening opposition.
We agree with the opening opposition that this debate is about more than just Ukraine and Russia, and that we have to defend this concept in a general sense. Ukraine is, as the opening government says, a good example, but one example can never reflect the totality of this world. But unlike what the opposition makers claim, we don't have to justify the stances that are often considered to be defending freedom at all costs. We certainly don't have to defend bombing the Middle East to supposedly free them. We don't have to defend free market policies that do not actually maximize the economy for most people, but rather the very few. We do not have to defend letting go and kill everyone or abandoning your job. Why is this? It's because freedom is tricky, and it requires you to balance things. We would support limiting a child's short-term freedom by forcing them to eat their vegetables in order to maximize their freedom later in life by ensuring that they have a healthy body that they can do what they want to with. This is a defense of freedom. It's the same reason why we wouldn't let you kill others, because it restricts their freedom. This already defeats the opening opposition's second argument that freedom is consequentially bad, because they fail to imagine a world with true freedom. They instead consider one where you maximize short-term freedom and don't think about what freedom itself actually is. What we do need to justify, however, is defending freedom at all costs. This means that we support sacrificing literally anything that we may need to sacrifice in order to defend that freedom. So, a question. Opposition bench. Can you, right now, give me any example of a scenario when you think you should restrict freedom for some reason that isn't simply to maximize a moral agent's future freedom? Because so far in the opening opposition, they've talked a big game about trading off freedom for utility, but haven't given even one example of this. This is the opposition burden, and that they can try to answer it at any point throughout my speech. If they don't, then they've already lost.
Lying to your mother on her deathbed.
Elaborate.
Well, if you lie to your mother or deathbed, we're not defending her future moral agency, but we still think that it's like a good thing to do, right?
No, but it defends your future moral agency, because it defends what you believe is correct in the future, and it means that you can live your life with freedom psychologically of having that certainty, of having the belief that you've done the right thing. Selfish. Try again later. Right. What is freedom? Freedom is genuine autonomy and choice. When the slaves are freed, they were given choice of their own lives. When we're talking about freeing people from the confines of cults, they have freedoms to make choices based on genuine information. It means informed consent to your choices. It means maximizing your capacity to consent and communicate things. It means maximizing the number of options that you have available to you when making a choice, always. How do we do this? Governmental policy, existentialism and religious standpoint. We think religions should promote the ideas of freedom over determinism. A micro level, when you're parenting your children, when you're interacting with your mother on her deathbed, and everything else that it could possibly include, including Ukraine. On free will, which is their other book, we are happy to concede for the sake of this debate that free will does not exist because they've proven this fairly well. But note a few things. One, we're still going to win on consequentialism. Two, if you believe that free will doesn't exist, then defending or not defending it also doesn't matter. So the motion is a moot point entirely, which it clearly isn't. So you should probably consider our arguments the same way that you consider the debate, i.e. if there's even a tiny chance that we have free will, it's the only way in which the choice that you as a judging panel make will matter, and you should probably judge it in that respect. But even if choice is a concept that only exists in the minds of people like opening government who believe in it, we still have an obligation to maximize what they believe freedom to be. A man who is hallucinating that he is free is still more free than the one who only sees a cage around him. Right? It is still a moral good when there's the belief that a wrong has been righted. You can still derive utility from believing that you are free, even if that freedom is not true, and if the opposition cares about utility, then they should care about this. So, two arguments. First, from a deontological standpoint, we're going to explain why we should maximize freedom at all costs on three levels, two reparatively and one on fundamental human dignity. Because we think reparatively there's an obligation from both the state and literally the entire universe itself to maximize their freedom. Why? Because the most basic obligation is to right the wrongs that you have done. The biggest wrongs that happened in your life happened when you were born. When you were born into a state that imposes laws upon you, a state that has created conditions of poverty, of racial and other inequalities that continue to limit your freedoms every single day as you exist, a state that you often cannot escape from, but if you do escape, you escape merely into another state that imposes similar restrictions on you. You're born into a universe that has laws of physics and biology that bind you to being in a suffering mortal body that will decay, get sick, and ultimately die a thankless death if that body limits what you have the ability to do with it. Yes, a medical student. This is the greatest inequity that can ever be done to you, because every other bad thing that damages your health or forces you to take time out or whatever is bad only because it limits your choice to be happy or whatever else it is that you want to do. What this means then is that remedying that inequity is the most important moral principle that we can hold, both as a state and as a universe itself, because giving you the most choice remedies the fact that that choice was taken away from you at birth. But even beyond that, it is a fundamental prerequisite for human dignity in its own right. What makes us human is this: we have moral value, we have agency, we make our own choices, or hell, maybe we just believe we do, but that is also fine. A piece of paper can serve the purpose of me scrawling whatever I want to over it and I can instrumentalize it as I will. But we think it is wrong for a person to be used as a mere means to an end. This is why it's okay for me to use Wordan to try and do well at Scottish debating championships, because I also sometimes value him as a human being and he knows this. But if I form a relationship with him and I'm purely manipulating him and using him for the sole purpose of winning a debating competition, we say that this is bad. Choice, therefore, is the opposite of instrumentalization, right? It says that you are being used for what you want and your desires, not those of another. You're a human being and not a piece of paper, a moral agent that bears some relevance. To fail to defend freedom at all costs is to fail what it means to be human in the simplest possible sense. Try again.
If there is an objective deontological framework, who decides how it is applied? Can I just throw someone in prison?
Who decides how it's applied? Unclear. Maybe it's God, maybe it's someone else, maybe it's the universe itself. I don't think it really matters, because I think in the framework that we've outlined the truth in this debate, there's a choice that matters. And probably what is good to the individual, which brings us on to the next point. Because I think that if there is a deontological framework, then maybe that framework matters to the person, and the person choosing how they can execute their own life is the most important thing there. Autonomy is the only non-instrumental good that there is. What is good? Good is different to each person. Good is defined as such. I value is the same thing that you value, and that is completely fine. If someone else goes and rearranges my bedroom because they think it makes more sense in this new layout, then they think it will be good for me, but I don't like it, but it's still a bad thing, because I ultimately am the one who does not like it. Good is never objective. There is always something that isn't good for someone, right? Some people don't value specific things that others do for religious reasons, for moral reasons, for spiritual ones. Some people are just like, I don't know, masochists, and that's fine too. What is good then is not about being able to do good, because good doesn't actually mean anything. It's only relative to what you believe. So we think that choice is good, not only in terms of allowing you to do good for yourself of what that specific definition is, but also about what the choice means to you. So even if you cannot do that good, believing that you can is good on two levels. First of all, so you have hope that you'll be able to help yourself in the future, hope that you'll be able to free yourself from the confines of whatever situation you're in. And secondly, power, because you know that your life is truly yours. It's the difference between free falling with or without a parachute. Even if that parachute doesn't work, believing that it will work is a good thing, but it gives you some solace in those moments, it gives you some perceived power over your own life. It affects your psychological perceptions of the world. And ultimately, that's the most important thing for utility, how you interpret the world. Because seeing negative things in a more positive light gives you more utility anyway. And so if you have that certainty, that is what utility is. I think that the opposition still hasn't met the burden I set out at the start of my speech. They can try again and utilize. If your life isn't actually yours, then why bother even living it at all?
Now, when it comes to the closing government speech, I may just be a dumb American, but what I got from that speech is that they like to toy with the definitions of what freedom actually means, but they do not in their speech give you a clear reason as to why we should defend freedom at all costs. They define what freedom is, and they say that we should defend freedom, but why should we defend this at all costs? Later on in my speech, I will begin explaining that the cost of freedom is freedom itself. Going on to the opening government's case, firstly, just talking about the actor of NATO. So earlier, the opening opposition did not really touch on the opening government's case, so I'll be touching on it now. And again, just going over NATO, they give you this example of how the Cuban Missile Crisis, when we did this, we drew that line in the sand and we stopped that conflict. But when we're looking at NATO specifically, NATO did not cause the Cuban Missile Crisis. NATO had nothing to do with that. So using that example and having NATO as its actor makes no sense. So what we're seeing here is that NATO is not the right actor in the certain context of this debate. And then again, going on to the fact that they want to solve war with more war, at the sacrifice of life and our inherent freedoms. So what we're seeing is that who are we to weigh freedom against human lives? They admit that lives will be lost, but what does that actually mean in this context? Our biggest fear as humans is death, but we're willing to dole this out to other people in order to protect our freedoms. Is that really worth it? We can see that it is not. Side of the opposition who humanizes this debate. We will see more loss of freedom with the open government. And again, just going into the closing opposition's case. So again, firstly, what are the costs of defending freedom? And do these costs outweigh the benefits of freedom? I'll be answering this in my first point. So again, the harm of defending freedom leads to a loss in freedom. When we defend at all costs, we are actually seeing a loss in freedom in this context. So an example would be thinking back to the civil rights movement in America around the 60s. So what we're seeing is that these people were fighting for their freedoms, fighting for their freedoms that were listed in our Constitution as people. But what we're seeing with this fight for freedom, we're seeing that they were thrown in jail, that they were pushed aside. We did not care about their freedoms. So when we're saying we're defending our freedom at all costs, we're actually experiencing a loss of freedom in this certain context and just in general. And again, another thing regarding the negatives of freedom is we're seeing another negative of defending freedom is actually a loss of human lives, just as the open government has stated and the closing government has stated in their speeches. And again, an example could be any revolutionary or civil war, any war in general. When we have these wars, we're seeing a loss of human lives because of them defending their freedom of them as countries. So, and again, as we're seeing this loss of freedom by defending freedom at all costs. Defending freedom just in general, yes, we can see some benefits, but defending at all costs, we're seeing a loss in freedom. And again, so going on to our second point about how we cannot actually defend full freedom at all costs, it's not feasible and it's not possible. So again, going to the first point, when we give our freedoms up every single day, we're doing that as citizens of a republic in order to have a stable society. So an example of giving up our freedoms and showing that we're not fully free is public Wi-Fi. So while I've been in the United Kingdom, I've had to hook up to a lot of Starbucks and Costa's public Wi-Fi. And when I'm doing this, I'm giving them my information in exchange for that Wi-Fi. So what I'm doing is actually affecting my right to privacy, which then again affects my right to be free. It affects that fundamental freedom. Another example would be, in the United States, the drinking age is 21. Here, the drinking age is 18. So when I go back to the United States, I'm giving up that freedom to drink in order to have that stable society that the United States wants for us. Every day, we give up freedom. We will never have full freedom in the status quo. We cannot defend freedom at all costs because we don't have freedom as it is. Going again into the impact of today's debate. So what we're seeing is that we are used to limiting freedoms to have a stable society.
Got you. So I haven't heard this yet, so I figured I'd ask, where's the actual response to the point that we bring up regarding we're defending the globe from the encroaching subjugation of imperialist forces from Russia?
So what we're seeing is that we're not actually seeing that benefit. We're not going to see that, especially with this actor of NATO, because you haven't given us any substantial evidence that they have done that in the past. And again, just going on to what I was saying, so we're used to limiting freedoms on a daily basis to have a stable society. So if we are to defend at all costs like the government wants us to do in today's debate, we will see even more loss of freedom, and we will also see that we're not actually going to be giving up these freedoms as a whole. And if we're giving up these freedoms, then we will descend into anarchy. If anybody can do whatever they want, then our stable society will become unstable. We can see that in many different ways. and once again, leads to a loss of freedom. So if you vote for the government, we're seeing a huge loss of freedom, even more than we would have in the status quo. There is no problem. Let's keep it as it is. So what exactly have I told you in my, yes?
How does us providing aid and support to a nation that lacks freedom not promoting more freedom?
But then again, like going back into what I said earlier, who exactly are we to say who needs freedom? Okay, and then again, just like what if I actually gone over and told you in today's speech? So again, just going over the closing and opening government speeches, we can see that the way that they're going about this is entirely wrong. And we're seeing that we cannot have this solvency, we cannot see these benefits because of the way that they're approaching this. Yes?
Isn't it a good thing that you can decide whether you want to connect to the Wi-Fi or not, rather than being forced to one way or the other?
Sure. And again, just going back into my case. So the first thing that I talked about was how exactly, answering the question, what are the costs of defending freedom, and do these outweigh the benefits of freedom? And we can see these do not outweigh the benefits of freedom because we're seeing an inherent loss of freedom if we were to defend freedom at all costs. And again, my second point was about how we cannot defend freedom at all costs in the status quo because it's just physically not feasible or possible. And if we do this, then we're going to see complete anarchy and the disassembling of our society as a whole. And with that, please vote for closing opposition. Thank you.
I'd like to thank our speaker for that fine speech and welcome the government whip to close for this. Here again.
Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on for them to do the same. A quote from Ronald Reagan, for the Americans in the room, including myself. OG is absolutely correct that freedom must be defended, importantly in the Ukraine conflict, but what we do uniquely is we're able to justify this course of action regardless of the consequences, because what OG is inherently reliant upon is they have to defend a freedom that results in positive consequences. They have to say that it is right to step into the Ukraine war even if we lose, even if NATO somehow is like overpowered, even if Russia is still able to expand. This is a course of action that we must take no matter what happens. What we are able to do is we are able to prove this. Firstly, responding to opening opposition, then responding to closing opposition, then me explaining our case. Okay, opening opposition, I won't lie, was a little confusing to me. But basically what I think that they're saying is that if utility is worse, whenever you are defending freedom at all costs, then this means that they are able to take the debate, because they do some wonderful weighing on why utility matters in and of itself, why we should care about people receiving benefits, experiencing some level of good. Two responses to this. I think the first one is that utility is maybe not necessarily the metric of this debate, because utility is only a good thing when it is able to maximize the choices that we make, right? We are all okay with people making choices that harm their utility because we believe they have the right to make those choices regardless of the outcome, right? We believe that it is probably a good thing for someone to be allowed to step in front of a car for someone else, because even if they are not able to derive any more utility from that action because they are now dead, the fact that they made that choice was a good thing, even though it may not have any utile actions of the world where they could fail in that particular attempt. I'll take word on.
You can see that it falls back to the feeling of freedom, yet it is only one feeling amongst many. Is it freedom if you are bound by obligation? Is it better to be caged or dead?
Okay, I think that freedom matters, freedom matters in and of itself. It's better to be dead than caged, basically. I'm perfectly willing to take this trade-off because I think that if I believe in something to an extent that I am willing to take my freedom to do something, to make a choice, and sacrifice my life for it, then I should be allowed to take that action. It should be defended that I am allowed to take this action necessarily, because if I judge that my choice is to be dead, I should be allowed to do that. Okay, on the disruption of the world. I think that they have to fall to proof of practicalities. I'll take you in a second, closing. I think basically what they say is that if everyone acts in a way that is free, then the world is going to be disrupted. The response that Adam gives to this is relatively simple. Basically, what we're doing is prioritizing freedom, but there are both higher and lower order freedoms functionally. right? Because a freedom that infringes on someone else's freedom is obviously a worse freedom than a freedom that is an a priori good, right? A freedom that does not harm anyone or does not cause any change to someone else's life is probably a better freedom than a freedom that causes someone else harm, right? This is why whenever we have higher and lower order freedoms, probably I am allowed to steal someone's wallet if it means that the money that I take will save someone else's life, even though this infringes upon the freedom of the wallet, the person whose wallet I've stolen, because this money might not have benefited them as much as this necessarily does. This means that we defend freedom even whenever it harms other people's freedoms, because what we do is we do a balanced way up. We take the nuance that opening opposition asks us to do, and we defend the freedom that is at the top at the most. No. I'll take closing now.
Yeah, so my question is, what exactly does freedom mean to opposing government here?
Freedom means the ability to make a choice. Like quite simply, that is it. As opening opposition says, as you also say to an extent, that freedom is the ability to make a choice. Let's respond to closing opposition's arguments then. I think basically what they say is that the cost of freedom is the loss of freedom itself. Two responses. Firstly, skill issue. Defend freedom better. Like if you are in a situation where the way that you are defending freedom is harming someone else's freedom, and this is not falling into the balancing act that I've already said, because this actually is just infringing upon someone's freedom more than it ever could, skill issue, defend it better. We're allowed to say that we are going to just defend it better. We're saying that we believe that it ought to be defended, and it ought to be defended in the best way it possibly can be, not necessarily in the worst way that it possibly can be. Second response is the higher versus lower order freedom thing. I think that if you are existing in a situation where somehow someone is suffering a loss of freedom as a consequence of trying to protect someone else's freedom, and like either this falls to my first response skill issue, or alternatively, this is simply a lower order freedom. This freedom does not matter as much as the one that they are fighting for, the one that they are working for, the one that they are defending. And this is a trade-off we are willing to make because we are willing to do this. I think the last one is that this is not feasible or possible because it will cause anarchy within the system. Maybe. I don't really care, right? I don't care if freedom causes anarchy in the system, because the system is a system that we have derived with our choices. It was freedom that allowed us to set up the system that we exist in the first place, and it is now freedom that allows us to decide to tear it down if that is a thing that we believe is a good and positive thing to do. Okay, we're done.
If a society makes a choice to subjugate 1% of its population to remain in prosperity, is this justified?
Does this create a higher order freedom, or does it not? Right? If you are subjugating 1% of your population, and the result is that you are able to access incredibly high levels of higher freedoms, because I think that the level of freedom you have to take from that 1% of the population is so very high that the metric you have to meet is incredibly, incredibly large. I just don't think that you will realistically ever end up in a scenario where you're doing that. Okay, connecting our case back then. Our case is relatively simple, right? I think that consequentially, maximizing freedom that doesn't harm other freedoms first is really, really important, right? Because this is also scalar. There are higher and lower order freedoms. Sometimes you are allowed to compromise someone else's freedom because it will save someone else's life, because to some people, the ultimate loss of freedom would be the loss of life because it means the inability to make future choices, right? I think secondly, regardless of the consequentialist outcomes, regardless of how you fall down on what's going to happen whenever we defend all of freedom, autonomy and freedom is crucial regardless, because choices are what make us human. We exist in a universe that has taken every choice from us, and the least the universe can do to give it is to try and give some level of it back to us, right? Because a choice and the ability...
Ultimately, my job as the opposition whip here is to close up this debate. What are the overarching ideas, and why exactly is... closing opposition here going to win this round? Ultimately here, we can look at the big ideas of opening government, for example, this idea of curbing Russia, this idea of a precedent of saving lives, again, with open opposition's ideas such as freedom, free will doesn't actually exist, freedom is a waste, and so on and so forth, which opening opposition, I firmly disagree with that statement, as well as closing opposition's entire case actually proving closing government's case actually proving closing opposition's case. So ultimately, we can go back and look at these points here. For example, closing the government actually fails to meet their own burden of defining exactly what freedom is to them, and how exactly do we defend it at all costs. Ultimately, what the government is advocating for is actually an infringement on freedom. like we see with the wallet analogy from the previous speech, that at all costs simply isn't possible, and that if we do this at all costs, we are eventually going to infringe on someone else's freedom. And so, therefore, the government's case actually falls to the closing government, to the closing opposition's side, ultimately because we again talk about the fact that you cannot have freedom at all costs without infringing on someone's freedom eventually. Again, if we defend someone's freedom at all costs, we lose freedom in the end. We can also see this if we move further. This boots on the ground point that the opening government tries to bring into today's debate. Ultimately, this boots on the ground issue is putting individuals' lives at risk. We're actually giving away resources that are dependent on keeping individuals alive, happy, and safe. We are throwing away individuals' lives and ultimately their freedom to exist as a person. Again, this is an infringement on one's freedom. Therefore, again, providing freedom at all costs is ultimately going to take away from others' freedoms. Again, we point back to closing opposition's case, such as the loss of freedom that we see and how there's actually never been no true freedom. We see with our point about the public Wi-Fi here, ultimately, yes, it is our choice to join the public Wi-Fi, but that point ultimately negates the fact that Wi-Fi is essential in our society. In any instance, in order to communicate, since we've been here, for example, we need Wi-Fi in order to receive messages and so on and so forth. We actually need this Wi-Fi. We have to give up a piece of our freedom for security by signing away our data in order to get something that we need, ultimately for the security of the nation. So we are actually seeing us having to give up freedom in order to receive safety. I'll take the question now.
So if loss of life is so important to you, why is it that the philosophical standpoint of determinism that there, essentially, we shouldn't do anything. Everything's already established. Doesn't that, again, justify doing nothing to save lives?
I'm not exactly sure I understand your question here, but my interpretation ultimately lies back again on this idea that if this all-cost argument is going to result in losing individual freedom. And that is exactly why we can't actually affirm your government's views on the resolution, because ultimately, again, we're actually going to see what the opposition is bringing forth prove in the long run. Your question.
Yeah, so where is the response to the point that we make regarding how the fact that while all this philosophical talk is great and confusing, it ultimately reinforces an ivory tower, and how does it apply to the real world?
Honestly, because these philosophical debates is exactly how we build the real world. It's exactly how we've created governments, how we've made decisions, and so on and so forth. That is why these philosophical analogies brought to you by the opposition ultimately uphold the real world policies that we see. Your question?
Wouldn't it be better if getting Wi-Fi and generally existing in the world didn't require you to give up freedom, though?
Because ultimately we are seeing security here. Because if we allow individuals to maintain every single degree of their right to privacy, we're actually going to see an openness to, we're actually going to see an infringement on our security. Ultimately, again, in order to protect lives, something that the opening government actually wants to do in this, we have to limit freedom to a certain extent. And that is exactly what we see with the closing opposition's case. Again, like the example that we see with the fighting for the civil rights movement. Ultimately, individuals had to give up their liberty in order to create any sort of progress to garner more freedom. What we are going to see is a precedent of needing to give up your freedom in order to protect freedom at all costs. And that is exactly where the opposition's points to stand. Your question.
But isn't saving a life maximizing that person's freedom, though?
I understand where you're coming from with that argument here, but again, that is ultimately our point. We actually can't see a protection of freedom at all costs if we're going to see freedom be limited in the end, in the long run. And that is exactly what the closing opposition is continuing to advocate for. Again, we are going to see a loss of freedom by pushing this freedom at all costs notion. And that is exactly why we see opening opposition bringing forth, again, these philosophical ideas. Because these philosophical ideas is how we ultimately approach this situation. Again, I point back to what the closing opposition has brought forth in today's debate, that there has actually been a precedent of never prioritizing freedom at all costs. Again, like we said, with our multiple analogies that we see with, again, the civil rights movement and the Wi-Fi issue, there has never been a precedent of any society, any government, anywhere, including NATO, prioritizing freedom at all costs, because there's always going to be a cost, there's always going to be a loss of freedom in order to gain something else. Any question?
So do you or do you not agree that we should take action to defend the freedom of the nation of Ukraine?
I would ultimately agree that action is needed, but we also have to understand that the infringement of freedom that we see based on the actions that you are advocating for, the actions that you are advocating for, and specifically this boots on the ground model and so on and so forth, is ultimately going to result in the loss of freedom. We can ultimately agree that one of the core tenets of freedom is the ability of life. We see it within things like the Declaration of Independence, John Locke, the philosopher. Again, life is a core concept of freedom and a right that should be guaranteed, and we're actually seeing that becoming infringed on this. I'm not going to negate the fact that Russia isn't also hurting that right by invading Ukraine. Ultimately, right, we should respond. But your response in particular is actually going to hurt freedom more in the long run. It isn't going to protect freedom at all costs. It is actually going to have other costs and hurt freedom in the long run. And that is ultimately why we fall back to this idea, again, that we cannot actually affirm the resolution provided here in today's debate, that this House will favor freedom at all costs, because again, we will always sacrifice something in order to protect ourselves, protect other freedoms, and so on and so forth. We will sacrifice that freedom to protect another issue, another thing. And again, that's exactly why we cannot affirm the resolution and what the closing opposition is bringing forth in today's debate. There has never been a precedent for this, nor should we, because we are ultimately going to again have more freedom lost. Thank you.
So we certainly witnessed a debate tonight, didn't we? All right, so what is happening right now is the adjudicators are stepping out, and there's an agreed upon maximum 20 minutes. Yeah, so what's the importance of that, Nora, as far as like generally in your experience, how long does it take for adjudicators to come up with a decision?
Supposed to take approximately 15 minutes. And this is partially just a logistical thing, right? Compositions need to run to time. You need to be out of this room at a specific time,
sure.
Things like that. But additionally, right, like if you're given all the time in the world to come to a call, you can go back and forth for ages and ages and ages. Sometimes you need more time, sometimes you need less time. But this 15-minute time slot is, I think, largely used so that every team gets their due, but you're not going around in circles, basically.
Okay, excellent. So what do you think the conversation is like out there? What's going on? How does a typical adjudication discussion happen?
So my guess is that the first step is that Esme, our chair, is going to have everyone try and come to a call in their minds first for the first maybe 3 minutes. Then Esme will go around, Esme will ask everyone what their call is, and they will begin discussing. So they'll probably discuss on the most contentious clash first, or the one that has the most disparities. So say two judges have OG first, and two judges have OG fourth. You're probably going to discuss that case first, and you're going to try and compare them to the other teams to figure out where they legitimately place in the debate. In that situation, they probably place in the middle.
Okay, so to help explain to our viewers at home, because we are not as familiar with this style of debate, we have a top half of the debate, and then we have a bottom half of the debate.
Yes.
So what we heard from the opening government was a very particular case, and then from the opening opposition, tell us kind of what you think happened there.
Yes, so this is slightly I think this debate will largely come down to practical versus principle clash. I think when OO frames the debate as a more broad definition, what they are largely using is what we use here for British Parliamentary called the World's Judging Manual. For example, OG, and this is what OO says, I believe, OG talks about Ukraine, NATO, all of these things. And I think think all these things are probably quite important. What OO, I think, is trying to say is that if these things are important, we need to prove why, and OG would need to prove why in order to be in line with this specific type of judging manual. Because within that type of judging manual, this house is a nebulous government or a nebulous actor, and it's often not as narrow a debate as OG sets out. I do think, though, that the setup that OG gives is very interesting. It has a lot of very compelling real-world impacts. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it seemed to me I was trying to flow a little bit, and then I wasn't able to as much as I wish I would have been able to. But it seemed to me like opening government gave us a very specific focus.
Yes.
Whereas the opening opposition is more of a broader philosophical, let's talk about all of these wonderful things here. So when things like that happen, Nora, would you say it's like two ships sailing in the night, or?
A little bit. Yeah. I do think so. I think this is one reason why I think this adjudication is going to be a difficult one. Because I do think when two teams, or even like two halves of the debate, have very different conceptions of what the debate should be about, responses, I think, are hard to find, and sometimes are just, or teams believe they are, integrated into the case itself. We notice this a lot on top half. I think we notice it less on back half, but on top half, absolutely, we notice that this exact two-ship situation happens, where both teams just have such wildly differing conceptions of the debate, that if the judges buy one case, they don't buy the other. Does that make sense?
Yeah, sure. So yeah, that definitely stuck out in my mind as I was watching and as I was viewing and analyzing what was going on.
Yeah,
so yeah, not a lot of what we back in America would call clash.
Yes. Yeah.
And hitting each other's arguments there. Okay, let's drop down to the bottom half of the debate. And so like what do you think happened down there? How would you explain this to our audience?
So I think that the biggest thing that happens on the bottom half is that CG explains or attempts to explain a framework of a hierarchy of freedoms and tries to explain why the highest form of freedom, i.e. a freedom that does not infringe upon other people's rights or has this balancing act that I think the GovWhip tells us about, should be defended at all costs. CO, and I think CO is fair to points out that we do not live under a system of freedom, and that it would be very difficult to defend freedom at all costs within a society that doesn't have freedom in the first place. This is another reason why I think this clash is going to be difficult to adjudicate.
Yeah, excellent. So, to explain to our viewers back home, we had four teams in this debate. We're typically used to two teams.
Yeah, of course.
And we have representation on both sides of the issue, which makes it really interesting because you have teammates essentially debating teammates.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, which is something that we are not necessarily used to, and that's kind of fun to see, especially as we look to that bottom half of the debate, because it seemed to me like closing government was spending a lot of time, of their time, talking about what happened from the opening opposition, which Edinburgh.
Yes. I think the thing is, here we are very used to debating color. We are very used to interacting with each other on that level. So I think this is a very natural thing for things, right? I think that CG spending a lot of time on OO, this may have been their strategic read of the debate, but this also may have just been them feeling more comfortable rebutting the people who they rebut all the time.
Sure. So is there a strategy, can it actually hurt your team and hurt the overall rankings there? Like what exactly happens?
So it really depends on what the team thinks. I think a lot of times who you focus on is probably based on who you think is winning the debate. So you're largely able to tell based on which team attacks which other team, who they think is winning, or what they think the ranking is. As a matter of fact, there will be some WISP speeches that just tell you what they think the ranking is.
Oh, that's interesting.
And so I think that it can absolutely be a strategic mistake if they're wrong. This happens all the time, where one team thinks that another team is winning and just ignores another team's point that's still standing.
Mm.
And that can absolutely be something that flips the debate.
Yeah, sure. So whenever you're choosing to respond, so when closing government is choosing to respond to opening opposition, yes, it might hurt them in the short term, but it keeps the opening opposition in the debate and in the conversation as they go along. So they were kind of able to continue to drag, I guess drag might not be the best word, but to keep the thoughts and the case of the opening opposition prevalent in this debate.
And if that's a clash that they believe is an important clash in the debate, that's very smart because it also keeps them in the conversation, doesn't it?
Sure. And then going back to opening government, those two gentlemen did an excellent job of keeping their case in the conversation by asking points of information. So
talk
to me a little bit about the strategy there, and what did you see? Like, what did you think of that approach?
So I think this was very smart strategically. I think in this debate was more point of information heavy than we might get otherwise. This is probably the most points of information I think I've seen possibly ever.
Yes.
But I think it's a really smart strategy, especially at the point where OG is aware that most of the other teams in the debate are not totally buying their perception. So it's a very smart idea for them to then be like, okay, the judges need to remember our case and need to remember who we are and what we say so that we don't get lost in the discussion.
Yeah.
And I think that was a really smart decision.
Yeah, I actually wrote down as I was taking notes, you know, both speeches, both sides, whenever they were able to ask questions of the closing opposition, opening government made sure to say, when we talked about this, where's your response?
Yeah.
And that specifically stuck out to me.
Yeah, so I think it's quite interesting. And I think it's, in this debate, a really strategic move. I think that there's some debates where that would be a worse idea. The reason for that being, if you think that your case is still standing, you don't want to give another team the chance to respond to it. Yeah. It might be less strategic to give someone the opportunity and remind them, hey, my case is still standing. But I think in this situation, it's quite a good idea because of the fact that I think most of the other teams in the debate took a very broad picture and they wanted to remind people of, like, what about this thing that we say? And I think that's very smart.
Yeah, yeah. So you mentioned that this was probably the most points of information that you've ever seen. General, typical competition, typical round. How many points of information are generally asked for each speaker?
So you could you ask them all the time. I think any time between the first minute and the sixth minute, because that's when protected time is here. But normally, a speaker will take one per speech. And largely focuses on the diagonal. So another reason you might have seen CG focusing largely on OO is because that's where the engagement is lacking. Same with CO and OG. I think that largely, you're going to get two POIs per team. This is because some speakers don't like to take POIs, so they make their partner take two. But yeah, this was very heavy, not necessarily on the asking. I think the asking was done a fair like bit, but in the accepting of it.
Good. So as the speaker, is there a benefit to taking more POIs?
So it really depends. It depends on if you think that your material is substantial enough to get you to 7 minutes. So a lot of times people will take more POIs if they're like, giving me a chance to respond is going to bolster my case. A lot of people who don't like to take POIs, it is because they have 7 minutes of jam-packed content that they just need to get out there, and they don't want to be interrupted or have their flow interrupted by it. But I think that a lot of speakers, I'm one of these speakers, find it very strategic and find it very fun to do that engagement, and it's part of the game for me.
Yeah, sure, and that engagement also allows an actual conversation and an actual dialogue there. And as we saw at one point, we had a little bit of humor thrown in by the leader of opening opposition, I believe. when asked that question, well, this world. So that was able to kind of break up a little bit of, I don't know that I would call it tense, but it did allow us the opportunity to breathe a little bit and to laugh and to have a little bit of enjoyment there. Okay, so in World's Debate, there's a term that I've learned called knifing.
Yes.
Can you explain knifing to us?
Knifing is when a team in closing gives a point that is directly contradictory and cannot coexist with what their opening said. The example I always use is if in the motion, this house would ban zoos, the opening government team said, well, we should ban zoos because animals should all be free. And then the closing government says, no, we should ban zoos so that we can put them all in aquariums, whatever. This would be directly contradictory because the two things cannot exist at the same time.
Gotcha. So would you say that what happened here, any type of knifing going on from the closing government by not directly...
So I personally don't think so.
Okay.
My reasoning for this is that I think that... well, I think that A, they do try and engage with the debate that is set out by OG. I think they do try to agree with Ukraine as an example, which I do think the DPM says that they're giving Ukraine as an example of a broader topic.
Sure.
I can understand why it may seem as though they knifed, however, in that they didn't directly engage with NATO as an actor. They didn't directly engage with the Ukraine-Russia argument. I think there's a couple of reasons why this isn't a knife. One of them is just that the World's Judging Manual lays out the way that this debate works. I think the CG team could have just said that, and that would have been a good addition to the debate. But additionally, I think that even if they had engaged on Russia and Ukraine, this was a good argument from OG that CG needed to get past to win. Does that make sense? Like, engaging on Russia and Ukraine, that's all been done. They need to do a broader idea. And I think that they're not knifing in that the Ukraine and Russia thing can absolutely exist within what CG says. They just try and take a broader conception of the debate. You could also call it accepting OO's perception or accepting CO's perception of the debate.
Interesting.
I could see it being seen as a knife, though. I did have that thought originally, and then I kind of tried to think through it a little bit.
Yeah, to me it seemed like, well, opening government had a very specific focus. Opening opposition had a more broad focus. And then it seemed like closing government had a little bit more of that broad focus as well. So it seemed to me like, that is exactly what was happening there. Okay, good. Anything else that you noticed in the debate that you think that we might need to mention or to explain?
I just think the thing that might be worth explaining is the role of the whip speech.
Oh, yeah.
Because I think in this debate, those whip speeches were incredibly important to clarifying the debate. Because in case the audience at home doesn't know, the whip speaker is not allowed to bring any new arguments into the debate. They're allowed to bring new mechanisms, they're allowed to bring new analysis, but they're not allowed to bring any, the way we describe it, is anything that you couldn't have reasonably guessed could be said based on what the member speech gave. And I think in this debate, these whip speeches were incredibly analytically rigorous, and I think that they did a lot of work to clarifying what I think is just a very confusing debate by the existence of it and by the way that the motion works and the way that the debate played out.
Okay, excellent. Well, Nora, can you tell us a little bit about your team, the debate union here at the University of Edinburgh? Maybe kind of explain, the majors that you have on the team, or what can you tell us about the debate union here?
Yeah, absolutely. So we are a very old debate union. I think we've been around for like 300 years at this point.
It's a little bit old, yes.
It's a little bit old. Older than the United States. So we do two majors over the course of the year. We do the European Debating Championship.
Okay.
We had a team break at that last year.
Excellent.
This year it's actually being held in Glasgow, so right in our backyard.
Okay.
And we have the World's University Debating Championship.
All right.
So obviously the only real difference there is that one hosts only European debaters and one hosts debaters from anywhere. We send we send teams to these, we send them on the basis of whether or not we think they could break at the competition, and whether we think they could do well. Traditionally, we've done relatively well. I think that as far as the team goes, we're a very tight-knit group.
Okay.
We debate at least twice a week. We have workshops on Mondays, in which which is more novice-friendly. Then we have our competitive training on Thursdays, which is like exactly what it sounds like, right?
Sure.
Training for the competitions that we do. We do competitions almost every weekend. I came back from one yesterday.
Oh, wow.
So like, we do them all the time.
Okay, so where was yesterday's competition?
Yesterday's competition was in Manchester.
Okay.
We were there all weekend. It went quite well. For me personally, it went quite well. For the team, it went quite well. There are multiple competitions in a weekend, so you often get people doing very well at multiple comps on the same day. Last weekend, not this past one, but the weekend before, we had we won 3 competitions.
Cool.
Just at different places, which was slightly insane.
Yeah, yeah. So, I know you have the European circuit, but where maybe more specifically do you travel to and have these competitions besides Manchester, which you just said? But like, how far out do you actually expand?
So we largely stay within Iona, right? So the islands of the Northern Atlantic,
okay.
Which is the UK and Ireland. Sometimes we'll go further. So we had a team attend the Copenhagen Open a few weekends ago. We have people don't go much outside of Europe because it's expensive and it's difficult to do, but
sure.
We do online competitions that are hosted all over the place, but we do a lot of competitions within Scotland, obviously, and the Scottish circuit is very healthy, and there are competitions all the time.
Excellent.
So we do that a lot.
Excellent. So about how many schools, universities, teams attend these competitions?
Manchester's competition was 40 teams.
Oh, wow.
I don't exactly know where the institution breakdown is. I forgot to check.
Sure.
But usually a competition is going to range between 20 teams and 60 teams, like a normal competition. Sometimes it runs smaller. Sometimes for things like the Oxford competitions, it runs bigger.
Sure.
But that's like the normal size of the competition, I'd say.
Okay. Now, correct me if I'm wrong on this, but you are a student-run team,
yes.
A student-run organization. So is that typical across most of these universities?
It is. In the UK, you really don't have faculty involvement in societies. Like, I'm the president of our society. I'm a third-year English literature student.
Okay.
The buck stops with me, you know? Technically, if something really bad happens, we go to, like, the student association.
Sure.
But we don't have faculty involvement at all. And this is, I think, largely true across the UK. I don't know about the rest of Europe, but I'm fairly certain it's normal there as well, that it's just student-run, student-funded, student-involved.
Yeah, excellent. So advantages, disadvantages to that? What are your thoughts on the student-run teams?
So advantages-wise, it's honestly quite cool to just get to hop on a plane to wherever you want without needing permission to do it. Like, I went to Ireland the other weekend. I'm going to Poland next month.
Oh.
It's like, and there's no bureaucracy I need to go through to do that. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
As far as disadvantages go, I think it's just, sometimes it's nice to have the support of what I might call a real adult. And sometimes it's a little bit complex when you're making these financial decisions and these decisions that affect a lot of your peers and your friends, that sometimes it might be nice to have a teacher who's a little bit more removed. But largely, I quite like it being a student-run association. I think that, I mean, I don't know, I can't say much, I'm president, so.
Sure, sure. Well, yeah, you can say that you're doing a really good job.
Yes,
and
great.
Yes, you are doing great. Yeah, excellent, excellent. All right, so this is our fourth day in Edinburgh.
Really?
We are leaving tomorrow. Where should we have eaten? What were the hot spots that we missed?
I don't know if you went to the Amber restaurant at the Scotch Whiskey Experience.
Sure did not.
That's right next to the castle. I actually work there. So
oh, okay. Oh, yeah.
But that's a lovely restaurant with really good Scottish fare. Around here, there's a lot of little places.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what you all like, but there's a lot of little places. just across the street is delicious. I'm a big fan of them. Soy 38 is a nice Thai place nearby. We have a ton of pubs that have great food, like the Old Hoos on St. Leonard Street. Incredible pub, love that. What have you seen? What have you been to?
Yeah, so I've been to a few places. For lunch today, I went to, the Conan Doyle.
Ooh.
Yeah, so I went somewhere that we had, I went out on a venture by myself to a place with, or a spot in the town that I'd never been to. And I don't think anybody else had been to either.
Okay.
Yeah, so it was really interesting, really neat. It seemed to be more of a local spot.
Yeah.
It seemed to be a lot more locals as opposed to us tourists. So I kind of stuck out like a sore thumb, especially with this voice.
Don't worry, I do too.
Yeah.
I live here.
Yeah, yeah. It's certainly interesting, that experience. And then a couple of days ago, we took the train to Stirling.
Oh, lovely.
And toured Stirling Castle.
Oh, yeah. I think I've been to Stirling Castle. It's lovely.
Yes,
it's a beautiful place.
Yes, and I know that we've hit up many charity shops.
Of course.
Across both Stirling and Edinburgh.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, we went and we're heading to St. Andrews.
Okay.
For a few days tomorrow.
Yeah, I've been
so.
There a few times.
Yeah, excellent. Well, anything else that you think our viewers at home and your viewers here, because I know that you have people that are going to want to watch this as well. Anything else that you'd like to mention?
Honestly, I just hope you all enjoyed your trip.
Absolutely.
I hope, everyone enjoys the debate, because I think it was a really interesting debate and a really fun one to interact with.
Yeah.
I just hope that the Montgomery Cup continues for a long time. I heard stories about it when I was a first year, because obviously it didn't happen as much during COVID.
Sure.
And I'm just grateful that it's back. Like,
yeah,
in
absolutely.
Full force.
Absolutely, yeah. So we have the Scottish tour, and then we have the Irish tour.
Ooh,
so
yeah.
we kind of alternate based on years there.
That's
so
great.
So yeah,
so
we.
I'm assuming you debated Trinity last year.
So this is my first year as the director. I took the place of Dr. Rogers, who is our tour leader here this year. And for those of you watching at home, yes, at some point we will bring Dr. Rogers on, and we will talk about the history of the Montgomery Cup and hear how his retirement is going. Very well, I think. So yeah, I know that he is enjoying this. But yeah, so I'm not entirely sure of the history of the teams that or of the universities that we've debated over the past few years, but that does sound familiar to me as we've discussed.
Competition or institutions in Ireland.
Sure.
They have two debating institutions.
Sure.
So I'd assume you'd have debated at least one of them.
Yes, I'm guessing multiple times probably.
Probably.
yeah. So whenever it comes to debate competitions over here, in the States, we also engage in speech competitions. So
yes.
We call speech and debate forensics. Are
yes.
there speech competitions that are offered over here?
It's really not a thing here. Like, I'll give you an insight into my past. I did congressional debating in high
okay.
school,
yeah.
And then moved over here. So I know speech, I know debate, I know forensics, all of that. It's just not a thing here. I think it should be. I don't know why it's not. Really, the only format of debate we do here is in schools. You do world schools style, which is 3v3. And then in university, you do British parliamentary, which is obviously what the viewers have just seen.
Sure.
And it's really not as diverse. I think doing speech, like humorous interpretation, dramatic interpretation, that's so fun. I wish we did it here.
Yeah. So we take a comprehensive approach to our
yes.
program, and we do both individual events and debate as well. Yeah, so we do a little bit of everything as far as University of Central Missouri, Lee College, and LSU Shreveport. Typically focus more on debate, and we do a style of debate called IPDA.
I think I've heard of that.
Yeah, International Public Debate Association,
yeah.
and then also Team IPDA. So,
oh,
so this is a natural fit, I think. All right, so our adjudicators have entered the room,
right.
So we are going to stop talking and let Esme have the floor.
But yeah, thank you so much. It was a really high quality debate.
All right, so we are up against time, so we are going to wrap things up. And we are being booted out of the room, but we will be back for the next set of debates. Follow our social media for the link. We will see you all later. Yep, thank you, Nora.